Hey y'all, Coach in the Fight here, talking about that great multitude which no man can number from Revelation chapter 7. And in this video, I'm going to show you how we can all be sure that we can be counted in that number. I'm also going to be showing you scripture related to the tribulation, as there is still yet debate on whether we are in the tribulation or not. And for the first time in a video, I'm going to be showing you scripture that tells us what the forbidden fruit is. That tree that got Eve and Adam in so much trouble? Well, turns out our Father has decided to use it for our good. And in this video, I'm going to show you how that fruit is now necessary for our salvation. So let's get started. First, giving all honor and praise to our Heavenly Father for these revelations. Let's look at verse 9. It says, "After this I beheld, and lo, a great multitude which no man can number." And by "after this" is talking about the selling of the 144,000 that took place in the first part of Revelation chapter 7. Now, there are a lot of people who seem to think that the 144,000 and the multitude that no man can number are actually the same people. But this can't be the case, because back in verse 4, we saw that the 144,000 consist of 12,000 people from each of the 12 tribes of Israel. And we'll cover who Israel is in another class. But notice in verse 9, it says that this multitude that no man can number, which would be well over 144,000 people, consists of people from all nations, and all kindreds, and all people, and all tongues. And when we look up a definition for the word all, it says the whole amount, quantity, or extent of. And in part B, it says as much as possible. Definition 2 says every member or individual component of. So whereas the 144,000 was limited to 12,000 people from the tribes of Israel, this multitude that no man can number comes from every nation and every kindred and every people and every language. It goes on to say that they stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes and palms in their hands. And this is the main part of this class, how these individuals are clothed in these white robes and these palms in their hands. Like I said, I'm going to show you what we have to do to make sure that we are included in this number, and the answer lies in these two phrases here, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. And when we come down to verse 13 out of the same chapter, it's also talking about these white robes. When you have one of the elders saying unto John, "What are these which are arrayed in white robes, and whence came they?" In verse 14, John is told, "These are they which came out of great tribulation, and have washed their robes, and made them white in the blood of the Lamb." Now, if you follow this channel, you know where this is headed, but let's talk about this great tribulation right here, right quick. Now, there is a lot of confusion around this word tribulation. There are a lot of people who know that humanity is in tribulation right now. But there are some who are having no part of this tribulation that will stand up quickly and say that we are not in tribulation. So let's look at what this angel is actually talking about here and click on the concordance number 2347. The Greek word would be something like thalipsis, and that's my first time pronouncing that word, so I know I got it wrong. But the definition is tribulation, but when you look at the usage, it says persecution, affliction, or distress. And to give those guys the benefit of the doubt when they are so quick to say that we're not in tribulation, I believe it's because they think that the tribulation involves global earthquakes and meteor showers and plagues that will devastate the earth. But notice that none of those apocalyptical events are listed here. It says persecution and affliction and distress. So could the word tribulation only be talking about the great day of the Lord, when we can expect those catastrophic events that will devastate the earth? I don't think so. Matter of fact, when you look at Matthew chapter 24, verse 29, it says, immediately after the tribulation of those days shall the sun be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light, and the stars shall fall from heaven, and the powers of the heavens shall be shaken. And when we look over in the book of Revelation in chapter 6, we see that the Messiah is talking about the great day of the Lord. So, when we're looking in Matthew chapter 24, we see that the tribulation comes before the day of the Lord. And that makes sense from what we learned in the concordance, that tribulation is talking about affliction and persecution. Well, I promise you that anybody who is out here fighting for the truth of the word of the Lord understands persecution and affliction. But that's all right, though, because it should be expected. Let's look at a few verses to see what I'm talking about there. Look at Acts chapter 14 and verse 22, which says, confirming the souls of the disciples and exhorting them to continue in the faith, and that we must, through much tribulation, enter the kingdom of heaven. So here we understand that if we ever want to see the kingdom of heaven, we must go through much tribulation. So when the angel is telling John about these people that shall come out of great tribulation, he's not talking about the apocalypse. He's talking about people that have been persecuted and suffered affliction, which we must endure if we want to see the kingdom of heaven. So now it should be easily understood why this multitude that no man can number are they which came out of this great tribulation. They are the ones who endured to the end of those persecutions and those afflictions that we must all endure if we want to see the kingdom of heaven. But let's go on. It says, these people are those who have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Now, that's the same thing we saw up in verse 9, where it says, clothed in white robes. So, what is he talking about? Clothed in white robes and palms in their hands. Now, the first time we hear about these clothes washed in blood is over in Genesis chapter 49, when we see the prophecy of the tribe of Judah. Judah washed his garments in wine and his clothes in the blood of grapes. And another place that we hear about the blood and these garments is over in Exodus chapter 29 and verse 21, when they're actually purifying Aaron and his sons by sprinkling blood on their clothes. Now, this was a common practice back in the day in order to purify their garments by the blood. And when we look at Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5, we learn that the Messiah washed us from our sins in his own blood. And Romans chapter 5 and verse 9 lets us know that this blood actually saves us from wrath. Talking about that great day of the Lord that we were speaking of earlier. So what is this all talking about? Garments washed in the blood of grapes and made white? This is what the Messiah was saying over in Matthew chapter 26 and verse 28 when he said, this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Our garments are made white when our sins are canceled out, or like it says here, we get remission for our sins. And we see confirmed here that this is the Messiah's blood that's actually washing away these sins or making our garments white. But what is he talking about? He's actually talking about the Passover celebration, a communion festival that we do once a year, just like they did in the old times where they took the blood every year in order to cleanse the tabernacle. Except now, our bodies are the tabernacle, and instead of using the blood of goats, we use the blood of grapes to cleanse our tabernacles. So, over here, what John was being told was that this multitude that no man could number will be those who participate in Passover every year. And let me show you one more verse that supports this idea, coming from the book of Jeremiah in the Septuagint translation of the Bible, down in chapter 31 and verse 8, where it's talking about that gathering that we hear about over there in the book of Matthew chapter 24. He says that he will gather us from the end of the earth to the feast of Passover. And then it even goes on to mention the great multitude. This is what the scripture means by line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. See how it is we have to jump around from book to book to find these verses? I believe our Father had to do it like this because if he had put all of the information in one place, the enemy would have deleted it, just like he deleted this phrase from the King James Version of the Bible. You only find this in the Septuagint translation, where it's talking about this multitude that will be gathered to the Feast of Passover. Now, this shouldn't be too surprising, especially when we reread John chapter 6, verse 53 through 54, where he says, "Except ye eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, ye have no life in you." And then in verse 54, it says, "Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day." So we learn here that the communion festival, which includes the bread that represents his flesh and the wine that represents his blood, is necessary if we want eternal life. But then you must ask, okay, well, what is this palms in their hands then? If the clothes are washed during the Passover, when do they have the palms in their hands? Well, the palms are in our hands during the Feast of Tabernacles, like we read in Leviticus chapter 23 and verse 40. The Feast of Tabernacles, which is exactly 6 months after Passover, is a week-long festival in which we are instructed to carry palm branches around, rejoicing before the Lord for 7 days. And when we come over here to the book of 2nd Esdras, and we look at two verses out of chapter 2, we see in verse 45 and 46, we see that it's talking about those who receive palms. And in 47, we see that they get these palms from the Son of God. But when we look back at verse 38, it's talking about the Feast of the Lord. It's talking about how we actually get our seal during the Feast of the Lord. And in verse 39 and 40, you see that it's talking about these glorious garments that are made white. So here, within a few verses of each other, you have the garments that are washed in the blood of the Lamb after being sealed at the Lord's feasts, at the same time that they are receiving these palms in their hands. Now, let me show you one other verse that supports this idea, coming from the book of 2 Maccabees, chapter 10, verses 6 through 8, when it is talking about the Feast of Hanukkah and how it is to be celebrated like the Feast of Tabernacles. Well, you see in verse 7 that celebration involves palm leaves. And other than sleeping in booths during that week, that is the main thing that you do during the Feast of Tabernacles, is you get these beautiful branches, including the leaves from palm trees, and you walk around singing hymns and celebrating for a week. This all being part of the purification of our temple. So the connection with all of this are the Lord's feasts, who John is hearing about. This great multitude that no man can number. Sure, they come from every nation and every kindred and every people and every tongue, but these are the people who actually keep the Lord's feasts. So, if we want to ensure ourselves that we are counted in this number, we have to keep the Lord's feasts. And here it is, May the 22nd of the year 2021. So you're probably thinking that you've missed the Feast of Passover in the year 2021, but let me remind you of Second Passover, which we can read about in the book of Numbers chapter 9, where we're actually given a second chance to do Passover 1 month later. Well, the second month in the year 2021 started on May the 12th, so Second Passover would actually start on the evening of May the 25th. And I just published a class a couple of days ago describing what we're supposed to do during the Feast of Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So go over there to check out that video to get all of the details. But the main thing you need to understand is that on Tuesday, May the 25th, is when we are to have that communion festival that we were reading about over there in the book of John in chapter 6 and Matthew in chapter 25. And then on the evening of May the 26th is when we'll have the Feast of Unleavened Bread. Now, as we approach the Feast of Passover, people always ask me if it's necessary to drink the wine or if grape juice is acceptable. And I always point them to the words of the Messiah, who during the Passover festival, when he filled the cup, he didn't say that it was a cup of wine. He said that it was a cup of the fruit of the vine. But really quickly, let me show you over in the Greek apocalypse of Baruch, or what's known as Third Baruch, how he was actually talking about wine. Now, we're down here in chapter 4 of Third Baruch, and we're going to come all the way down to verse 8, where Baruch is talking to an angel and said, "I pray thee, show me which of the tree which led Adam astray." And the angel said to me, "It is the vine, which the angel Samuel planted." See, we learn in another part of the scripture that the trees of the garden were planted by the angels. One angel planted the nut tree, while another angel planted the apple tree, and so forth. But it was Samuel, or that angel that we now refer to as Satan, that planted the vine tree, or the grapevine. And when Samuel transgressed, the Lord was angry with him and not only cursed him, but he cursed the grapevine as well. And we learn in this book that, symbolically speaking, the grapevine was the forbidden fruit that our Father told Adam not to touch. But it was the same vine that the devil used to deceive Eve and caused Adam to be cursed as well. And we learn also in this chapter that after the flood, Noah found this vine, and when he understood its significance, he prayed for 40 days. And look at what he was told. In verse 15, it says, "Arise, Noah, and plant the shoot of the vine, for thus saith the Lord, its bitterness shall be changed into sweetness, and its curse shall become a blessing. And that which is produced from it shall become the blood of God. And as through it the human race obtained this condemnation, so again, through Emmanuel, our Messiah, will they receive in him the upward calling and the entry into paradise." Now, I would suggest you keep reading on, because don't think that our Father is telling us to drink wine every day. It goes on to remind us that wine is a mocker. But on this specific day, on Passover, the wine that comes from the fruit of the vine is the ultimate blessing. But go over there and check out that other video, which has all of the details in it. It tells us exactly what we're supposed to be doing if we want to keep these feasts. And go ahead and subscribe to this channel, because as the repairers of the breach, that's what we focus on over here at Coaching Fight, or Hermas Academy as we like to call it. We focus on the feast days. And like last year and the year before, and even the year before that, Lord willing, we'll do classes throughout the year as the feast days come up, letting us know exactly when the feast days are and what it is we're supposed to be doing on those days. And may our Father bless you and keep you. May he make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May our Father lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.